to the next set of weapons, can we go to Japanese swords? Can you show us anything Japanese, please?
Yeah, a beginner when
Let me
it comes
see.
to Japanese swords. I've noticed that the real experts, they spend their entire life studying only Japanese, and it's not something you can easily do on the
No, of
side.
course.
But I buy things that at least I understand. This is one of them. What I like about this is that it was preserved with its original mount.
Yeah.
And you probably know that Japanese swords are usually sold in their resting scabbard, and then
Yes.
the mounts are often sold separately. So these sets are separated and never get together again. So this is actually, it says something about the taste of the samurai. But the reason why they so easily separate the two is that in the 19th century, a samurai would have many mounts for his sword. So it was just one appearance of the sword and not the appearance. So there's a bit more of a disconnect than in most cultures. This is just a decent sword. It's a Mino blade, and it's unsigned and it's shortened a little bit. And the MBTHK, this Judge Federation, they do assign it to a smith, but it could be any smith on that level in that area. So they assign it to a name, but it doesn't say it's actually made by him.
Yeah. Can I see the hammer one more time, please? I know it's very hard to, I see that. Yeah, thank you very much.
Yeah.
Beautiful.
And the other one is, know a little bit more about it. This comes in the typical Shirasaya without any mount.
Yes.
This is made by Kunikyo. So here it says the smith's name. It's hard to see probably, but it says Yamashiro no Kami Kunikyo,
Wow.
and he had the right to show the chrysanthemum on.
Yes, I see that.
Yeah, so he was a very good smith who was asked to come to a local daimyo because the daimyo wanted to learn how to make swords, but he couldn't hang out with normal people, so he gave a couple of swordsmiths a noble title, so it was appropriate for them to meet and then talk about swordsmithing. So that's why he got the title, just to be close to the local daimyo. The interesting part is this side.
Yeah.
Here it says that Yamano came on Nagahisa, cut through two bodies in, I think, 1666. So 6 year of Kanbun, 68, I think. And on the cut is the Mitsudo, so the nipple height. And these were usually they're already dead because it was distracting if they were still screaming, according to this cutter. He was actually the main executioner for the shogun, Marcus Sesco, who's you probably know him. He's a researcher in Japanese arms. He wrote a book about this tradition of test cutting. And he's actually the founder of the line of test cutters who would inlay the results of the cut in the blade. And the cut itself would be about as expensive as a good sword. So this guy was really quite something. He was a bit like the Michael Schumacher of swords. If you had a good sword and you wanted to know, you want somebody to test it, you gave it to him because he used swords every day in a deadly manner. And this was beginning Edo, that a lot of samurai didn't fight anymore. They knew about war stories, maybe from their grandparents. So when they had a new sword, they wanted to know, is it a good sword? And they gave it to this guy. And then if it went through these bodies without taking any damage on the bones, it was considered good and got this mark of approval. And it was also often done on swords that were to be gifted. So then the receiver knew that it was a good gift.
What a beautiful sword. This is amazing, Peter.
And it has the hogimono, so
Yes, I'm looking at the horimono as well.
it has bamboo on one side and chrysanthemum on the other.
On the other, yeah.
And he actually did this himself, this smith. Normally it was a profession of someone else, but this smith was known to actually cut them themselves.
Beautiful.
And I've seen similar patterns on other swords from the same period. So these, this type of decoration was quite in vogue in the 1660s.
Let me stress one thing which I forgot to mention in the beginning. And I'm saying it openly now. I hope I'm not going to step on anyone's toes. Guys, you want to learn something, go to Peter's site. It is one of the most detailed site on antiques, arms and armor when someone wants to learn. So it's not that Peter only trades in them. I mean, this is so academic. So I really need to praise you for what you offer the community for your website. I have really so detailed, so well researched, Peter. I really need to congratulate you. I wanted to do it in the beginning. I was so mesmerized talking about antique arms. I forgot that. So, you know, beautiful sword. Very good. Excellent. Thank you for sharing it. Magnificent. Yeah, very nice. Very nice. And I'm sure there are many Japanese martial artists here and Kenjutsu practitioners, Yai Jutsu, they would really appreciate that. Very nice. Thank you very much. Very good. Okay, Peter, let's move to another country which made beautiful arms and armor swords in India. Do you have any Indian items you could share with us? Antique arms and armor from India.
Yeah, I have a lot, actually. South India, North India, early...
Let's start with both, please, because they're so different to each other.
Yeah. One of the things I like myself is South India, because a lot of their weapons... in the North, they put gold on everything. Mm-hmm. If it's important, there's a lot of gold on it. And in South India, they had this aesthetic that they let the lines of the sword speak for itself. And sometimes there's some gold or silver, but it's the geometry that they find most important.
This is, I'll show you some kata,
which I think is from the Deccan, late 17th to early 18th century.
Yeah.
And what I really, really like about this piece is this sculptural form.
Oh.
It's like a sculpture in steel. And this is as precise as the better Ottoman daggers. It's probably modeled after one. It really follows that shape.
Is it the patent crucible steel? I cannot tell from here.
It looks like it might be, but it's... it has lost its finish. And I used to etch everything out of curiosity, but nowadays I became a little bit more conservative. So
yeah, I believe you.
Yeah, I usually leave pieces the way they are, but I do see some slight activity. I think it's probably wood. Yeah. Mm-hmm. It has two little lions here that are, it's really hard to see in this light, but they're...
I see them.
Their tails are entangled.
Yes, and then Asian lion,
Yeah, and then the sidebar have these openings.
Yes.
Yeah, so this is the kind of stuff I really like. And going back a little bit earlier, this is... probably 16th century. This is a kanda, or actually a patisa, they call them. And it also has this little lions here. And then this nice geometry on this.
God, what a piece.
And then it forms this spoon-like shape.
Yeah.
It's really like the beak of a spoonbill. And some people think they actually might have been modeled after that. And this is wood, I think. Can you see it?
It is. I can see it. Yes, it is. It is.
It's a big chunk. And often with these really big ones, you see lap welds. But this is really one piece. So that's also quite rare. Yeah, this is maybe my best Indian sword at the moment. So there's one in the British Museum. But this one is slightly more detailed. So I'm quite pleased with this one.
Yeah, it's a magnificent piece.
Thank you. And then there's another South Indian piece. Which is very early.
Yeah.
It's forward curving.
Oh, God, yeah.
It's like a very long cookie.
Exactly, like, I just want to ask you. Yeah. Okay.
And it's beautifully done in brass.
Oh, God.
And the thing is, it's probably a revival piece, so it's not as old as it pretends to be. It's probably, I think, 18th century, and there's a lot of jingles made for a Nayar ceremony. So this was the warrior caste of South India, one of the warrior castes, and they would have temples full of swords, and their ceremonies would always involve dancing with a sword.
Oh, okay, I just want to ask about the ceremonies. Okay.
Yeah, so this is probably one of these, because the if you see the hilt blade constructions, not super strong.
Yeah.
And the blade is quite thin.
Yeah.
It's not really a fighting blade. And this is much more ornate than the earlier fighting pieces. I've had them as well. I don't have any at the moment. But the workmanship is really, really nice on this.
Yes, it is.
Clearly someone...
For our viewers to make sure, the former Southern Indian pieces you showed, they were fighting pieces, right?
Yeah.
Exactly. Just wanted to make sure so people don't get confused. Okay.
Yeah. And then we can move to North India. Two more South Indian pieces, maybe.
Oh, yes, please.
This is one of my favorite daggers. I bought this, I think, 5 or 6 years ago. And I've never had the heart to actually put it on my site. Because I'm like, the money I can get for it will never make up for the loss I feel. It's just it has a movable tongue.
Oh, God. Yeah, it does. I've never seen that before.
And it was just a lovely little blade with palm motifs engraved in it.
Is it a horse hat?
This is a Yali, which is like a mythical half lion, half bird kind of.
Can thing. I see it close? Because I couldn't see it. Oh, that's right.
Yeah.
No, I see it. Okay. I see it close. Okay. I see that.
A bit of a dragon-like head.
Yes.
And the body is a lion, but sometimes it's a bird. And in this case, it's a bird.
It's a bird, yeah.
Yeah. Cute. And I just kept this thing around. Sometimes I look at it. They usually call them Yali daggers, named after this, but nobody really knows what they're named. And you never see... any artwork depicting them. So we know that this kind of comb is a popular shape in the Malabar coast. So it's probably from the western part of the southern coast. But that's pretty much all I can say about it. And this used to be an imperial symbol up to the 17th century, but this piece is probably 18th century. So you cannot really say it's an imperial dagger. It's just made after a shape that was the old imperial mark. So it is quite interesting. And then this is, of course, a more well-known shape.
Yeah, of course.
Yes, yeah, the Kanjali.
Yes.
And they are a little bit related. If you look at the shape, and they have this little butt here.
Yeah, they are.
Yeah.
Very good comparison. That's right.
All right, North India.
Yes, please, North India.
This is one of my favorite pieces that I own at the moment. This is a typical 18th century blade, so late Mughal. It's made of woods with a lap weld here. And the wood is pretty hard to see because it's very fine wood. It's not like the Persian woods with the clear marks. It's a little more dotty.
Yes.
And usually when you find them in original condition, it's all mirror polish. So this was a wood that was not actually for show. They just wanted the properties of the material, but they were not showing it off because it's not as consistent as the Persian stuff is. And the hilt, this is a beautiful Delhi type hilt.
Oh, God, yeah.
In Delhi, they had this like vase-like shape in the middle, and it's all true inlay. It's hard to see.
Yeah. I see that, yeah.
But all the silver is really inlaid, and almost all of these hilts have overlay, and overlay looks good when it's new, but it soon starts to wear off, and then you see the cross hatching, and this is still in really good shape after all these years. And then I have another one, 18th century, and this one is still in original mirror finish, so you cannot see any detail. And you can see it's original because there are these marks here, the burnisher's marks.
You see them.
And almost all of them lost them because a lot of collectors, like I was in the past, they're curious. So they sand it and then etch it to find the woods. So then these marks get lost. But if you look at old collections in armories there, Most of them still have it.
They have it, yeah, that's right.
And the hilt, this is a typical Jodhpur type hilt.
Mm-hmm.
And this is all done in silver and gold.
Oh God, what a beautiful piece.
Yeah, quite something, this one.
Yeah, I see that.
And it's a bit of a puzzling piece,
mm-hmm.
because it's inscribed here as being a gift.
Can I see that? Oh no, I cannot see it from this distance.
Yeah, it's here.
Oh, I see that. It's in Hindi.
Yeah. And it says it's a gift to Maharaja Bhakt Singh, who was ruling over Marwar at the time. And Jodhpur was the main city. So the hilt, the quality of the hilt is royal. And the shape is indeed Jodhpur. But the date of the gift is a few years after this guy died. And that puzzles me. So this is a riddle I still need to solve. I know there were several calendars in use, but it does say Samvat, which is pretty much the standardized calendar at the time.
Can I see the, what kind of color does the adhesive material have?
In between the...
Yeah?
It's a bit of a reddish brown.
Reddish brown. Okay, thank you very much.
Yeah. Yeah, this was actually published in one of Elgood's books.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, at some point it was on the market. So I'm like, oh, wow, this is interesting. But I haven't published it yet because I don't like to publish things that I don't understand. So I'm still studying this and trying to work out what the inscription is about.
Beautiful.
Thank you.
Thanks for sharing all these.
Northern, these are Qatar. And yeah, like I said, when it's northern and it's quality, then they just put a lot of gold on there, like this. And this is interesting because it's it has a marking here. Can you see?
Yeah.
This was a wedding gift to someone in 1821. So we have a date, and this was someone from Sindh, actually, from Sindh province, who got it. And the scabbard actually. Where is it? The scabbard has a nice silver work.
Yeah.
Whenever you see this kind of thick silver, which is pierced like this, it's from Sindh.
Beautiful.
And the only thing I don't know is whether this one is made in Sindh, because it could be that it was given and then given a local scabbard.
Yeah.
Because the shape with this rounder dome.
Mm-hmm.
is almost referring to South India, and these were done in the south of Rajasthan, which is a couple of hundred miles from where it was given. So I think it's from somewhere else. But yeah, India is difficult because craftsmen always moved around and ideas moved around. So yeah.
And,
this is also a funny one. This is for a child. So it's quite small.
Yeah.
These guys are quite young when they already started to learn how to use these. And it's nice inlaid with gold.
Yeah, very nice.
Pattern welded blade.
Oh, it's pattern welded, okay.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's hard to see, but you see the little circles here and there.
Yes. Yeah, I see them now.
Yeah.
Very nice.
Yeah. Thank you.
Peter, I just forgot, I know it's... part of China. Do you have anything from Tibet to share with us?
Yeah.
Oh, that's beautiful. Sorry that I changed the subject so now.
Oh, no problem. Let me see Tibet. I do not have a lot at the moment,
okay.
But I have some pieces. First, start with a piece of very typical Tibetan metalwork. This is a saddle plate.
Oh God, this is so fascinating. Yeah.
It has one leg is missing, unfortunately, yeah. But it's not in the case. And this is actually, well, you'll recognize probably because it's strongly inspired on Persian work.
Yeah.
Also with the way it swirls. The earlier it is, the more it's like Persian work. And this is somewhat a rare shape that it goes back like that. And I think this is, I discussed it with someone from the Met, Dolo La Roca, and he thinks this is probably from Eastern Tibet with this shape like this. Mm-hmm. And of course the Chinese love this. So they started to make sword guards with this type of thing. And some of those sword guards actually made it to Japan, where they're known as Namban Tsuba.
Yeah.
But some of them are actually not made in Japan. And a few Nihonto collectors know that some of the guards and their swords are actually made in China. One of the most exciting Tibetan pieces I have at the moment, or actually by far the most exciting, is this one.
Wow.
And
okay.
Yeah, it's a lovely piece. It has, these are corals.
Yeah.
They're imported all the way from the Mediterranean.
Yeah.
And this is ray skin from the coast of Southeast Asia. And of course, this was incredibly expensive all the way up in the Himalayan plateau. So that's why they had it, because it was so exotic. And inside is a small dagger, typical Tibetan hairpin fulging. So it has, let me see, it has these lines. What's interesting about this one is that the Qianlong Emperor had one. And it is incorporated in a list of items that he collected. And it has a date. He was 40 years old when he got it. No, 41. I'm 41 at this point as well. And he got it after a war in Jinchuan, which is what is now Sichuan, bordering Tibet. And this came from a local chief who, or at least the one Qianlong had, came from a local chief there. And it was collected between 1748 and 1752. So that puts the date of this also at that point or before. So it's quite early for something Tibetan. And, and it's nice to know that in this specific area, the chiefs would have a piece like that. So we have a little bit more context than we do with most of these.
Beautiful. Thank you very much.
Yeah, you're welcome.
Peter, can we move now to Persia, to Iran?